this. So there are some programs that are showing benefits in terms of really making intensive lifestyle change and getting those health outcomes that we need. And the absolute classic person and that has spearheaded this is Dr. Dean Ornish, which most of you probably know that name. And in the world of lifestyle medicine, it's sort of like way back when everybody thought the world was flat, and then somebody said, no, I think the world is round. Well, that's kind of what Dean Ornish did for lifestyle, because in those days, we thought, okay, somebody has heart disease, that's it. There's nothing you can do about it. And he said, wait a minute, I think people lie about what they tell you that they actually eat. I'm going to lock them up in a hotel room for 28 days, which is the most that he could talk the hotel into letting them have the rooms for free. I'm going to lock them up. I'm going to make sure I know exactly what they eat. And I can prove to you that we can absolutely reverse heart disease. We can absolutely treat heart disease. And we do not need medication for it. Anyway, so there, I've done my little pedestal thing. okay, so there you go. There's the Ornish study, and again, yeah. Familiar with the 10% fat vegetarian diet, which people said that's just so extreme. How can anyone do that? Many people can do that. They can do it successfully. They can change their palate. They can have beautiful food that they fully enjoy. So now in the lifestyle medicine community, we're increasing our culinary medicine skills, and we're teaching physicians and other healthcare providers how to cook this way. So it tastes good, it looks good, it smells good, it's a beautiful experience, and it's a social experience. So the other program that's ongoing and widely known is the Complete Health Improvement Program, the CHIP program. Again, people are brought in and they're really taught all of these healthy lifestyle skills. And you can see for yourself that, you know, what they came in with at baseline and after this intervention, after coming to these weekly sessions, how they've been able to impact their weight, their blood pressure, their cholesterol, and their glucose. I talked about legumes and the blue zones. Fruits and vegetables are also a key part of a healthy diet. So specific to cardiovascular disease, thrown in some data around that. And the more the better. It seems that there is a bit of a threshold around 5 servings, and that's probably why we have the, you know, traditionally had the 5 fruits and vegetables campaign, you know, we've had here, but really, still, you can go beyond, and you saw, see here in the Epic Heart study, you can go to 8 portions and get a continued progression in, or lowering in risk. Same for stroke. And what I really want to get to, though, is the association of fruits and vegetables and emotional health. And actually, fruits and vegetables, that if you're not familiar with nutritionfacts.org, which is pulled together by Dr. Michael Greger, he does a lovely job of summarizing, he and his colleagues and students that work with him, a lovely job of summarizing the latest studies. And so there, if you go to that nutritionfacts.org and actually there's a search function and you search for like mental illness, depression, you will find the studies that show that you can actually treat depression with fruits and vegetables. I mean, at least you can improve the symptoms, maybe not completely reverse it. Maybe you're not starting with major depressive disorder, but something more moderate or mild, but you can certainly turn around a lot of depressive cases. But let's say we're talking about the general population. The general population, we all need a boost in our emotional well-being. Every single patient walking through our healthcare system. So fruits and vegetables help with our overall emotional well-being. And how much? Well, at least one study, this was a study with students, we certainly need more studies, says, I mean, it's still a lot to see meaningful change in your mood. You're talking 7.2 daily servings of fruit, 8.2 daily servings of vegetables. Then the really interesting thing is that then, okay, fruits and vegetables can help your mood, and if you're in a better emotional state, you're much more likely to reach for those fruits and vegetables. You're more likely to reach for that apple than for the chocolate cake. And so then it becomes a cycle, okay? So healthy eating and mental health go both directions. Some really fascinating early data. So So then that speaks to the fact that we need to do more around psychosocial factors to boost emotional well-being so we can get people to eat healthier, so we can prevent and treat chronic diseases. And so that's the area that I've now recently been focusing on, and I'm working with the American College of Lifestyle Medicine to actually develop an entire center around what we may be calling the Center of Happiness Medicine, which is, there is a lot of research around what it is that boosts emotional well-being among the general population, and here's a list of some of those factors. This is serious research. There's actually serious research around even the physiologic factors of simple things. And I'll give you an example. If you're not familiar with Barbara Fredrickson, she's a leading researcher in the area around positive psychology. She works out of the University of North Carolina. And so she has been able to demonstrate that with loving kindness meditation, and later really just with little micro moments of connection, like a few seconds of genuine connection with another human being, which you can have hundreds of those connections throughout the day, that actually lowers blood pressure and improves vagal tone. So we've got some early hard science that there's more to all this psychosocial business that we need to be pulling into a what I call total health and part of a lifestyle medicine approach to, again, preventing and treating disease. Of course, many of us are familiar with transcendental meditation. I threw that in as an example of how those who, in this particular case, it was a study of blacks and their ability to lower their secondary prevention of cardiovascular disease through having a regular transcendental meditation. So I want to now just shift gears just for a few minutes and talk a little bit more about this lifestyle medicine movement. So what is the definition of lifestyle medicine? The American College of Lifestyle Medicine just defines it simply as the use of lifestyle interventions in the treatment and management of disease. And so what is the role of lifestyle medicine? It focuses on those lifestyle changes, and it really should be with every kind of clinical practice and with every patient. There's something that we need to be tweaking in terms of lifestyle for every patient. Remember that earlier study where I said only like 3% of them were actually even being consistently doing those four healthy lifestyle factors? So we all could use a lot of help. It's a collaborative model with the patient, and it's very limited. It's really looking at just what you eat, how active you are, how much sleep you get, what are those social connections. So there are a couple of slides here from, there's a textbook, comes out of Australia by Gary Egger, and it's just called Lifestyle Medicine, and it compares conventional medicine to lifestyle medicine. And again, for the sake of time, I won't go into too much detail, but just imagine that in more conventional medicine, the physician and patient are talking, and the physician is writing that prescription for the statin, which again, statins are great in certain circumstances, but there's so much we can do to avoid the statins. Whereas in a lifestyle medicine practice, we're really gonna have to fully engage. It's more than a prescription. It's gonna be really sitting down, working with team members, working with a nutritionist, working with a psychologist, a coach, and others, and finding out what a patient needs 24/7 to get that support to make a full lifestyle change. So in 2009, there was a Blue Ribbon panel convened, a national Blue Ribbon panel, to say, well, what are the skills and knowledge that a physician or healthcare provider needs in order to offer high-quality lifestyle medicine? And so you can see representatives from a number of organizations. It was monumental because we were able to get a consensus statement after a lot of negotiating back and forth over a one-year period from all of these organizations to say, okay, yep, this is the definition of lifestyle medicine, and this is what high-quality lifestyle medicine means. And we published this in 2010. And basically, the group said, evidence-based practice of helping individuals and families adopt and sustain healthy behaviors that affect health and quality of life, as you can imagine. Bottom line is, we need to be able to do diagnostic assessments that are looking for the lifestyle pieces. We need to actually go beyond national guidelines and beyond. I talked about how the dietary guidelines, 2015 dietary guidelines, are a good step in the right direction, but we can offer so much more intensive, particularly around interventions for helping people get that whole food, plant-based diet. But clearly, it's going to take a team approach. It's not a doctor and a patient over a 10 or 15 minute visit. Absolutely, it's going to take that. It's going to take community resources and referrals and some of that information technology and restructuring how our healthcare system works and how a particular visit how we follow up with the patients between visits. That all has to change. And then the consensus panel said, absolutely, we also need to make sure that all the providers, the physicians themselves, are practicing these healthy behaviors. Because once they're doing it, once they're understanding how this makes them feel so much better, they're going to be that much more enthusiastic in working with their patients. And there's a slew of data, which I didn't even include here. One of the leading researchers in this area is Erica Frank. If you Google Erica Frank, a lot of her students who practice this, she showed were more likely to be working with their patients around healthy behaviors. Here's a list of what the 15 competencies are. This is also in that JAMA article we published. And so again, for the sake of time, I've just basically summarized that for you, that physicians and healthcare leaders need to show that we believe in lifestyle change as the foundation to medicine. Everything else stems from that. We still do need medications in some cases. We do need surgeries in some cases. We need all of that. But it all has to be built on a healthy lifestyle to begin with. And then going on down with management skills, working with our patients, working with their families, because this is a family affair, and what they come home to, who does the grocery shopping, what's in the cupboard, that kind of thing. Who they have to work out with or just go for a walk with. And this, I think, summarizes some of what I've been saying in terms of how do you implement this. This is tough work to implement. We need to have vital signs that are around lifestyle front and center. I know Kaiser, Jim Salas, worked for years and years to add physical activity as a lifestyle measure in the Kaiser system. But there's so much more to lifestyle is what I've been talking about that could be front and center as part of the medical chart. Team-based care, group visits where patients learn from each other. Shared medical appointments are absolutely a way to help lifestyle medicine move forward. And then these support programs in the community that can help us. And so that's a good segue into using the National Diabetes Prevention Program as an example. So right now there is a collaboration going on between the Centers for Disease Control, the American College of Preventive Medicine, the American Medical Association, and the YMCA USA, YUSA. To figure out, and there's some big money put into this, to figure out how do we help patients across all kinds of healthcare systems, including we're looking at FQHCs, we're looking at academic institutions and many other places, how do we get those patients into those programs? Some insurers cover this, some don't. We think we were supposed to have this covered by Medicare on January 1st, 2018. I don't know what's going to happen with that. So we're moving in this direction because, again, it takes a village. It takes more than what's happening inside the walls of the healthcare systems to help our patients lead these healthy lifestyles. That is a 12-month program, 6 months weekly visits, and then monthly visits for the next 6 months, focusing on physical activity, the 115 minutes per week that's recommended, and guidelines, the dietary changes that I've already talked about. It can be done virtual or live, so there are a lot of digital programs that are coming out to help with that. So then that leads me to, but we've got to train the elephant. So I don't know if any of you, I'm in the health behavior field. Lifestyle medicine really is about changing behavior of providers as well as the patients. So there's a book called Switch, if you're not familiar with that, by the Heath brothers. And what they created, this beautiful image of a rider on an elephant on the road. So the road is the guidelines that we develop. We know where we should be going. The rider is, okay, the mind, we're telling the mind, we're telling our patients, this is what needs to happen. The elephant is the emotions that guide that behavior. And if that elephant is not on in line with what the writer wants to do, we're going to get right off track. We're not going to follow that recommended path. So that emotional, psychosocial, motivational, inspirational point is so absolutely important. So again, another entree into my emphasizing the area that I'm hoping to elevate within lifestyle medicine around mindfulness, savoring joy, gratitude, spirituality, meaning and purpose. Again, entire workshops that we'll be doing on all of that. So in summary, because I want to just have enough time to show you an inspirational video, is the behavioral determinants, of course, are crucial to health outcomes. There's a large body of evidence pointing us in that direction. There's the blue zones that also point us into how we can live to be 100 and more. Clearly, this field of lifestyle medicine is now taking off to really embrace all of what we know and put it front and center in healthcare more broadly, that we need all the help we can get. And so one example of that, of some beautiful programs, is the National Diabetes Prevention Program. And again, there's so much more work to be done at many levels, but particularly the psychosocial level. So with that, can you help me with the video?
So while we go to your video, I just want to ask, so if we can take a cardiovascular risk down by 30%, and you can answer it after this.
Okay, sure.
With lifestyle, how far can you take it down?
Yes.
Why does life sometimes feel so wrong? Running in circles and you don't belong. I always knew that this day would come. It's time to break free.
And I didn't show that slide, maybe down to 3 to 5%. So almost zero. So Other questions?
Thank you. Great presentation. I just wanted to put a plug in for two resources. One is Healthy Kitchens, Healthy Lives, which is a four-day conference put together by Harvard School of Public Health every February in Napa Valley. Excellent topic. And the second one is just an easy-to-find video, Forks Over Knives, that expands on this. And I just wanted to comment that culinary medicine and teaching patients how to chop, how to cook, is a big growing field. And there are some initial pilots in the East Coast between medical schools, schools of nutrition, public health, departments of education, and departments of healthcare, bringing kitchens into FQHCs, into hospitals, into cardiovascular preventive programs. Are we doing anything like that in California?
I don't know specifically to California. I can't answer that. But I'm very involved with the American College of Lifestyle Medicine. And in fact, some of those resources you mentioned are on there. I think it's lifestylemedicine.org. That organization, as well as the American College of Preventive Medicine, are going to be expanding the culinary medicine trainings for physicians. In fact, ACLM, I think, just got a grant where there are going to be many, many hours of training for physicians and other healthcare providers. So we're going in that direction, but I don't know about specifically to California. But a lot of that, obviously, will be available to all of you, even as you're in California.
Are you saying that genetics plays less of a role now than it may have in the past? Where does genetics come in? I know that's not your thing, but it just seems like genetics should not be overlooked as well.
Yes, so clearly genetics is a factor, and there's only so much that can be done in terms of turning that around, but that's again a whole nother talk. There is this area of epigenetics, and so a lot of our healthy lifestyles not only have sort of that effect on blood pressure or cholesterol, etc., the risk factors we traditionally look at, but they actually can make changes on the parts of our genes, the outside part of our genes called the epigenetics. We can do quite a lot to really overcome our genetic predispositions, although clearly some, like hereditary hyperlipidemias, that kind of thing, clearly have a component that they're going to be needing medications probably. And so again, there is a role for medications, there is a role for our more traditional health care. It's just a matter of how do we balance that. But for most people, just the lifestyle piece is going to be enough, and then there'll be some groups that need more.
By show of hands, I'm just curious, how many people in this room would be willing to work toward making Sacramento a blue zone?
She's already on it.
I guess
this is interesting, Hattie, because we talked about the natural blue zones. We talked about the natural blue zones, but there are now a number of cities across the country that are looking to just create a blue zone. So that's, I think, what you're talking about. And so actually one of those is in Naples, where the American College of Lifestyle Medicine had our conference this last October. And the report the happiness report was just released. I'm going to forget the name of it. On the happiest cities, and Naples is number one, and I think that has a lot to do with what I just talked about. So, thank you.
Naples, Florida?
Naples, Florida. I guess it would be nice too. Thanks for the clarifying.
Thank you so much. Great presentation. And mentioned it's up here. We're going to have our next meeting is not going to be here, so don't come next month. It's going to be April 10th at 1414 K Street, number 500 at the California Endowment, where we'll be joining with a care transitions and care coordination team that is being supported by HSAG. And I think it's going to be very interesting as we merge some of the discussions that we have in terms of our aim in cardiovascular risk reductions, along with the work that the care coordination group is doing in the institution. So should be a very interesting discussion. I hope all of you can make it. We ordered a nice day, nicer than this today, so hopefully you will get that order filled. But thank you so much, and if our two speakers could stay just for a little while. I know there's a lot more questions. I know you're busy, and we really appreciate you being here, but this has been a great presentation, a set of presentations, and we really appreciate the fact that they complemented each other so well. Thank you.